Okay, hi folks. So welcome to the second talk on the four foundations of the fourth of the four foundations of mindfulness, dhammas. So yesterday we had Maitrisiddhi introducing this area to us, and she was explaining how this fourth foundation, basically it's about truth. It's about truth. It's about seeing clearly. It's about letting our minds become clear so we can see clearly. So it's talking about all the different teachings and methods and practices by which our minds clarify and we can see the nature of reality and we can live well and stop causing ourselves and others suffering. How marvellous would that be? How marvellous would that be? Okay, partly I'm just kind of like, I don't think I'm going to be able to do this talk in a very slick way. And actually, it's because I suppose it's like, this is the one that I care about most. I mean, I'm not sure that I would practice mindfulness if there wasn't this fourth foundation of mindfulness there. It's like, it's like the reason for why I really deeply want to practice the other three foundations of mindfulness, being aware of my body, being aware of Vedanas, pleasant, unpleasant, neutral, and being aware of my thoughts and emotions. So the sort of two ways of kind of like relating to this area around dhammas. So one is we practice these first three foundations of mindfulness, and as we do this, our mind quietens and clears. So it's like those glasses of water that Maitrisiddhi had yesterday. And as we go deeper and allow our experience and stay with it on deeper and deeper levels, our mind clears and we are able to see the nature of experience, which is how suffering is created and how we cannot create it, how everything is impermanent and flowing, and this relational aspect of reality, this interconnectedness. So that's sort of one direction it can go. Our mind clears and then we're able to see reality. But actually we can do it in a different direction as well, where it's like we bring to mind the nature of reality. And actually our mind comes into contact with truth. And that clears our mind. Our mind just sort of naturally settles. It's like if we choose a different perspective to see through. It's like if I take off my glasses, everything's really blurry and I can't really see very much. It's just sort of blurry colours. But if I then put on the glasses where I am looking through the truth teachings at my experience, I can see more clearly. It's like, and it opens up direct experience to me in a way that doesn't happen otherwise. So one way this can happen is, say we're in a bit of a state, happens to me quite often, I'm in a bit of a state, actually we can kind of think, at this point I could go to the truth teachings. What would be a helpful truth teaching for me at this point? And perhaps we drop in something like, this will change. This will change. And sometimes for me it's like I then just existentially relax. It's like, oh, this will change. I don't have to get in a big state about it. This will change. And from that position of ease, then it's like my body opens out. It's like I can notice physical experience. I can notice, oh, this is pleasant or this is painful. I can notice, I've got all these tangled thoughts going on. I can allow space around my experience. And it's a question of finding which truth teaching does this for you. So sometimes for me it's around suffering. It's like, painful experience arises for everyone. It's not that I've done something wrong. And again, there's this sort of relaxation, this sort of ease. Sometimes it might be around interconnectedness or love, where I just, you know, again, touch one of the Buddha's key teachings. Maybe the one where he says, hatred never ceases by hatred. It only ceases by love. This is just the way things are. And again, there's just this, I drop that in. And there's this sort of ease, my body relaxes, and direct experience can kind of open out from there. So that's one way in which we can apply this fourth foundation of mindfulness, consciously bringing the teachings to mind, and then noticing, oh, what effect does hearing the truth have on my body, mind, my psyche? I'm trying to change tack slightly and talk about something else, which is actually in the title of this talk, which is around metta, truth in our own experience. So it's like I'm sort of doing the other half to Maitrisiddhi's talk. So, you know, yesterday she was drawing out, how in our own experience do we see impermanence, interconnectedness, unsatisfactoriness? How do we do that? And the Buddha teaches these three marks of conditioned existence again and again and again. But another teaching that he teaches again and again and again is around metta, around kindness, around a well-wishing and a solidarity for all life. And this is just as much an expression of reality as the three marks of conditioned existence. So there's a lovely quote from Sangharakshita. This is from Living with Kindness, where he says, "The point of cultivating metta is to bring you closer to reality. Kind or benevolent thought or action, while it's of course good in itself, is an expression of love only so far as it conduces to a realization of the true nature of things." So there we've got a statement that unconditional kindness is as fundamental to the nature of reality as impermanence or any of the other concepts around reality. So the question for me is, okay, so the Buddha tells me this. How do I see this in my own experience? How do I know that this is true? And this aspect of needing to see the truth of the Buddha's teaching in our own experience is fundamental to the tradition. You know, the Buddha says again and again, well, you know, you need to see it for yourself. You know, don't just believe me. You know, he says, test my words in the fire of your own experience, as a goldsmith tests gold in a fire. And there's a gorgeous story, which I totally don't have time to go into, where there's a load of confused people saying to the Buddha, well, how do we know what are your teachings? It could be anything. Some people are saying this, some people are saying that, some people are saying the three marks of conditioned existence, some people are saying it's metta. How do we know? And the Buddha gives like a whole teaching around that, but the nub of it is he says, when you know in yourself, when you know in yourself that this teaching leads to absence of ill will, absence of craving, to contentment, to openness, to expansiveness, when you know in yourself. So he's pointing at this fact that actually we do have that faculty to know in ourselves what is helpful, what is taking us in the right direction, which way leads to the ending of suffering, what is truth. You know, it's like we, in a way, if we can be enough in contact with our own experience, actually we wouldn't need the truth teachings. But as it is, we have the truth teachings, and then the question is, and how do we know them in our own experience? How do we look at them in our own experience? The meditation for today is a gratitude bhavana. And in that meditation, we recollect, we consciously bring to awareness ways in which we are interdependent, ways in which, what have we been given by this world, by all our connections through the course of our lives, what sustains our life in this world. We bring to mind what we have been given. And so it's a sort of direct meditation on conditionality, or the fact that we are not independent. When we were looking at citta, this area of thoughts and emotions, Maitrisiddhi drew out this aspect where actually our intellectual understanding about the world and our emotions are not separate in the way they're separated out in Western thought. And what that means is, as we see more clearly, actually our hearts also get purified. You know, it's not just our minds that settle out like the glasses of water. It's like our hearts settle out like the glasses of water. And on seeing clearly, we do see, oh, actually, there's a sensitivity that's inherent to our experience. Actually, like, we do care. When we see conditionality, actually, gratitude is what arises. Like, it's natural. That just sort of happens when we look, when we notice, when we recollect aspects of our experience that often we can just ignore. So this is just me thinking slightly. The Buddha actually teaches, I don't know, I just love the early stories of the Buddha. I mean, I just love the early stories of the Buddha. It's just like, I mean, they're really random apart from anything, you know, you just get all sorts, and some of them are really boring and some of them are really fascinating. But anyway, you get all these stories where the Buddha is just walking through ancient India and he's teaching different practices to different people. And it's not unusual for him to teach practices around recollecting, noticing what happens when we act ethically, or what happens when we are generous, or we act with, we choose love rather than harming. We choose generosity rather than stinginess. We choose contentment rather than craving. We choose honesty and authenticity rather than being false. And when we choose awareness rather than distraction or intoxication. So those are the five key ethical precepts taught, you know, across all different Buddhist schools. But again and again, the Buddha is saying, well, don't just do it. reflect in your own experience. So there's this really, really gorgeous story where actually it starts by the Buddha telling all his monks to go and dance naked in the rain, but I don't have time to tell you about that bit. But it is quite an exciting bit. But anyhow, when we go on to the sort of dharmic part, what happens is you've got a lady called Visakha, and she's just living in the local town. She's married, she's got children, she's got grandchildren, she's quite well off, and she's a follower of the Buddha. She's practicing the Buddhist teachings. And one day, when the monks have finished dancing naked in the rain, she manages to find the Buddha, and she says to him, "Oh, look, I've really been thinking about this, and I would like to give these gifts to the Sangha, the community of practitioners." And she goes through 8 different things that she would like to give. And I won't go through all of them, but it's like sort of food for ill practitioners and people going on a journey. She would like to supply them with some food for so that they can set off without trouble. The one that I like best actually is the nuns, the female followers of the Buddha, are bathing in the river, not wearing anything, you know, they're washing. And the prostitutes are making fun of them because they're not wearing anything to bathe. And she says, "I'd really like to give them swimsuits so that they can go and bathe without having the prostitutes make fun of them." Anyhow, I love these bits. But the point is, she wants to give these things. And the Buddha doesn't just say, "Oh yes, Visakha, I've said generosity is a really good thing. What a marvellous idea, why don't you do that?" He gets her to go through a whole reflection process around it. So he says, "Oh, so Visakha, why do you want to be generous in that way?" And she thinks, "Oh, why do I?" And first of all, she goes through all the benefits that her generosity would have in the world. Like, it's really difficult if you're looking after an ill practitioner and you've got to go and find your own food. That's actually quite difficult. But if I give the sick nurse some food, well, that'll just like ease things up for the person that's ill and the sick nurse. And if I give the nuns swimsuits to wash in, you know, the prostitutes won't make fun of them, you know. So she goes through the whole list of things that she wants to give, and she says, "Oh, well, look, it would have this effect in the world." And you'd think, great, marvellous, that's why we're generous, isn't it? You know, to do good things in the world. You know, and so we are, you know. But the Buddha isn't content with that. And he questions her again, and he says, "But Visakha, what benefit do you foresee for yourself in giving these things?" And you can imagine her just sort of thinking, "Oh, I hadn't quite thought of that." I mean, this is my imagination, it doesn't quite draw it out like this, but I can sort of imagine her kind of like going into herself and noticing her own experience and noticing, well, what happens internally for her when she brings to mind her generosity. And then she says this really, really gorgeous thing. She says a really gorgeous thing. So she says, it's more or less like this. "When I bring awareness to my own generosity, then I feel glad. And when I feel glad, then I just feel happy. And when I feel happy, my body becomes tranquil. I just relax. And when my body is relaxed and tranquil, I experience pleasure. And when I experience pleasure, actually my mind relaxes, and then I'm able to become concentrated and absorbed." And at that moment, you know, she's got a naturally absorbed mind. And then she says, "Oh, well, when my mind is in that state, actually mindfulness just arises for me, along with the other faculties of spiritual practice." So, things like faith or trust, energy, direct understanding of reality. You know, actually, all this just starts naturally arising in my mind. And all this is in a consequence of my generosity, me giving, and then a process of reflecting and really like letting you know, how does that feel? You know, what is that like when I have been generous? And I just really, really love that. I really love that. And I feel this is a practice of recollection and mindfulness that we could really take on a lot more. And it is a practice of mindfulness, and it does fit in this fourth category of dhammas, like bringing to mind the teachings and practices, and then noticing in our own experience, well, what effect do they have when we're kind, truthful, aware, etc.? And also the opposite, you know, well, what effect does it have when we don't do those things? But I do think it's significant as well that actually the Buddha gets her basically to rejoice in her own positive practice. It's not the only place that the Buddha does that. You know, he asks people to, you know, consciously rejoice in their own practice of generosity, love, ethics. And there are these two aspects here, being aware of our effect in the world, because this isn't just, you know, it's like actually we practice for ourselves and we practice for our effect in the world. Like it's both. It's not one or the other, it's both. Yes. Because when we bring to mind the positive effects of our practice, actually what that means is we will want to do it. We will want to bring awareness. We will want to bring mindfulness. I mean, you'll notice that we've got the four foundations of mindfulness. There's like sort of mindfulness is a whole thing, but it is also an aspect of ethics. Bringing awareness is an ethical act. And as we become more aware, the aware mind perceives interconnectedness and relatedness in the world. And that means the aware mind also perceives with love. It's like our heart opens when that happens. And then our practice and our action in the world become more aligned with reality, because actually we care more. We take people into account. We take this natural world into account. We practice mindfulness, we practice awareness. This changes who we are, this changes how we are, this changes the choices we make in the world. And not from a place of kind of like feeling we should do or we ought to, but just because actually that's just naturally how we want to express ourselves. And you know, it's part of living with a greater sense of joy and pleasure and delight and just a sense of like being part of things. It's like we're not separate. We don't have to live as though we're separate. And this is so much more deeply fulfilling and nourishing, like so much more than, you know, what we can imagine when we're living little separate cut off lives. And we move in this direction through developing these four foundations of mindfulness. All of them, direct awareness of body, of feeling tone, vedana, of our thoughts and emotions. Our mind clarifies, we see with a mind of love, we bring the truth teachings into our experience. This is the path, this is the path, and I love it, I love it.